Hello YouTube, my name is Dragonheart, the Prince of Wales, and welcome to a faction overview video for Total War Rome 2, and today we are looking at Carthage as a faction. So basically, this is the description here on the left hand side. I'm not going to read all of it, I'm just going to quickly or slowly go through it. You can pause the video anytime you want to read all of this. I'm just going to go through it like that. There we go. So we're going to look at the traits. So basically, Phoenician trade heritage, plus 10% wealth from all commerce buildings and mercenary armies, minus 25% mercenary upkeep cost. So basically, what that is saying to us is mercenaries are the way to go. You do get very good offers on the mercenaries and they are cheaper. Now, of course, with Carthage, they have different sub-factions, I call them. You have the Barsid Dynasty, you have the Hananid Dynasty, and Maganid Dynasty. So it's up to you. I go for Barsid mainly because Hannibal Barca is my favorite general and that is his family there. Like the other tutorials that I'm going to be doing and the other overviews, I'm going to be playing on hard difficulty. A Carthage campaign is on hard difficulty anyway, so they are a difficult faction to play as, so it's probably best to play as these guys if you if you're more of an advanced Total War player. So with the Barsid, agricultural reform, so plus 10% wealth from agriculture buildings. Punic Faith, you have a moderate diplomatic penalty with all factions. Popular support, so public order bonus of plus 4 from the presence of our culture. So there we go, guys. I'm just going to click the start button. I shall see you all on the campaign map. Hello and welcome to the campaign map. So, straight away we are greeted by an objective issue. And that issue is to completely control 3 provinces either by direct ownership or through client states and military allies. If we do this, we get a treasury reward of plus 2,500 denarii. So it's worth doing that. 3 provinces shouldn't be too difficult, although Carthage is a difficult faction to play as. Now at the moment, if we go on to it here, you can see Africa is under our control. We have the capital, which is Carthage itself, and then we have our client state of Libya. They have Lepsis, Thapsus, and Machomedes all along the coast. Now, sometimes in my campaigns, they've declared war on me. They've backstabbed me. Always be wary of Libya. That is the first number one rule. Be wary of Libya because they can hurt you. Secondly, we have our other allies across here. Nova Carthago. They have Iol, which looks like LOL. And they also have Tingis. And they have Gadira. So they are another faction which we are kind of happy with. Although Mauritania also has Migdol and Dimidi. Now Migdol and Dimidi, I think Migdol is down here. The Gaetuli have that. And then Dimidi is here. So unless they come out here or unless you take it, then this province won't be under your control. And third province over here then, Carthaginis. You have Ibosim over here. And you have Carthadash, which is here. And you also have an army which is led by Mago here. But you do need to take that arse, and you need to take Numitania, which is all the way up there. So it's quite a difficult one to go for, quite a bit of distance. You have to travel in Iberia. So it's up to you. The only thing I should say is, though, that you're actually not at war with these guys to begin with. So it's not urgent. You know, you don't have to take this straight away, but it is something you need to think about. And of course, these are key settlements to take. If you take Numantia and arse, then you've got a nice big kind of hold on Spain, and that's what you need to do in this campaign. So we're going to drift across the Mediterranean Sea now to where all the action is, and that is here. So who do we start off at war with? Let's have a look. We don't actually start off at war. Oh, we do. The Turtadani we start off at war with, which is over here. So if we go over to that part of the map, there we go. Lovely. They have Cartuba. Cartuba is a wall settlement, so it will take quite a while to take the settlement. And of course, your army, which is going to attack there, is probably going to be this army here, which is the Friends of the Four, the Friends of the 104, led by Mago. So, what do we have? We have mercenary Iberian swordsmen. So straight away, it might be worth disbanding these. However, you do have to pay. You do pay less for your mercenaries as Carthage. So it's up to you. Personally, I think it's better to recruit your own units and develop them over time than rely on mercenaries, but they are useful. And because Carthage does have a bonus, you're not paying as much as you would as other factions. I do think, though, you need to recruit a lot more men. As you can see, Carthadash, you can only recruit Libyan javelin men and Libyan hoplites or hoplites. So you're limited. You don't have very good troops here in Carthage. You need to upgrade this straight away. Carthage, upgrade straight away. And you've got two. You can actually upgrade it twice, but we're only going to upgrade it once, and we're going to actually get a muster field. At least that way we can get Carthaginian hoplites. We're going to do that straight away. Carthaginian hoplites. Must get them. Get them in Carthage. Otherwise, Spain will be very hard to look after. My general, no point sitting out here like a dumb person. We're just going to sit in Carthage. Defend it. The more people we got here, the best we can defend. Be defensive in Spain on the first couple of turns. I learned that the hard way. I went out from Carthage. I threw myself at Cartu, but I took it eventually. I was stretched. I ended up losing Carthage. My allies over here, Nova Carthago, were useless, and they just kept getting defeated all over the battlefield, all over the campaign map, and they were gone. And eventually I was surrounded by loads of enemies, and I just couldn't survive. And I ended up having to concentrate on the Mediterranean and just leave Iberia because it was useless. So always, you know, try and defend Carthage and try and make sure you get better troop quality. We can upgrade it again, but I'm not going to bother doing that. Ibosim, again, you know, is it going to be attacked? And probably not. It's not really a strategical settlement where it is. As long as you stay friends with the Edani and Sesitani here, you're going to be fine. So don't worry about that for now. Of course, public order is a bit low. It's minus 14. So if you look at that, it's saying it's going to be a rebellion in 8 turns. Cultural differences is the main reason why. So what you want to do is get Punic culture in these settlements. So maybe you can do that at Ibosim. Let's have a look. Let's see. So we can upgrade these. Plus 10% wealth from agriculture. Public order plus one public order per turn. That might be useful eventually. But we're going to actually expand again. And this time we're going to be getting a consecrated ground. This will give us public order plus 2 anyway. It will also give us plus 2 Punic culture. That's important. Consecrated ground, get that straight away. So they're the first two things I'm going to build. That muster field to get better troop quality. And that to get better public order in this region. That is important. I would definitely go for those two things if you're going to concentrate on Spain initially. Now, Mediterranean. What are we going to do in the Mediterranean? It's a big, big area to survey. Lots and lots of settlements. We have Carthage, Lilibium, Caralis. Now, Alalia in the top, in the north here, is actually held by the Etruscan League. Now, we will need that eventually because we need to get Corsica et Sardinia. Now, Rome starts off at war with the Etruscans. They might not attack you straight away. Now, it's a double-edged sword, really, because while they're fighting them, you might be able to take out Syracuse and give yourself a nice little hold here. In one of my campaigns I played before, Epirus actually came over and took Brundisium. I was at war with Epirus and not at war with Rome, so I was able to sail up there and take it without having to lose any diplomatic points with Rome. It's how you manage your campaign. Always look at your strategies, okay? So, moving on, technology. We want to start off fighting, we want to get better troop quality, so we're going to go for the logistics, and of course we're going to be getting, let's see, what is it? Mercenary upkeep, that would be useful. That might be a possibility. Let's have a look. Charge bonus, definitely. Morale for all land units, definitely. So we're going to go for that. Physical conditioning, rights of Melkart. They're going to be useful initially starting off as well. Now my spy is just sitting there. He doesn't need to sit there, he can be used. We're going to use you. You're going to go to Syracuse, army at Syracuse, ship at Syracuse, you need to take that land. Lilibium, of course, doesn't have anything, and we can actually expand the land again. Now, we have the great man himself, Hannibal, sitting here at Carthage. We don't want him to be sitting, we want him to be fighting. What can we recruit at Carthage? Again, Libyan hoplites and Libyan javelinmen are not good enough. It's definitely not good enough. So what we're going to be doing at Carthage is upgrading, expand again, and again we can only go for a muster field because we haven't got the technology, but that's okay because Carthaginian hoplites will do at the early stage of this campaign. They are better than what we currently have, and we're going to be doing that. We can of course recruit some Libyan javelin men. That would be useful, two of them to begin with. We're going to be using a few javelin men with Hannibal anyway, and we have a ship at Caralis. Now Caralis is minus 7 public order. Lilibium is minus 16. It's minus 16, if we have a look over, because of the cultural differences. So again, it's the same story. Culture is the problem. We need to sort that out. Now, what we could do, actually, is get rid of one of them. That will probably give us enough to expand, which it does. And again, we're going to be going for consecrated ground to give us that plus 2 Punic culture. and +2 public order. That's important. Always remember Punic culture, consecrated grounds. Build them as quickly as you can, consolidate what you have, and then push on. That's how you do well in the Carthage campaign, and that's what we're going to do. Now, these ships, we're going to be at the Libyum, because again, you know, we have no army there. We don't have a general there to defend the Libyum, so our ships can go there and defend it instead. And I think that is pretty much everything that we wanted to do. I'm just going to now go on to the factions. Oh, not that one. Let's see. Provinces. Forces. Jezebel has been moved. The Friends of the 400. Yeah. We've used our army. Moved our armies. Moved our spy. That's pretty much everything we need to do. Moved our ship as well. So to finalize this turn, we're going to go into diplomacy. Check out who likes us. The Etruscans like us. Of course they like us. We hate Rome. They hate Rome. They're at war with Rome, actually. So we could probably get something with them. We already have a non-aggression pact. Trade is moderate. We're actually going to try and get something out of them, though. Maybe 500 coins. It's low. Maybe not. Trade? No. Okay, fair enough. They won't trade with me, which is a shame. Doesn't matter, though. Masaili would be useful to get a non-aggression pact with them, seeing as they are very close to our borders. Non-aggression pact is moderate, and it's been accepted. That's fantastic, because we have our allies here, Nova Carthago, and then these guys. So hopefully we won't get attacked from the south at Carthage, which is useful. We can't trade with them, because we haven't got a landlock, or a proper landlock border. So that's fine, though. We might end up trading with them in the future. And then Sesitani, of course, they're not in our kind of scope at the moment, because they're up here at Tarraconensis. And not here, so maybe a non-aggression pact with them would be good, but we can't get it, so it's not the end of the world. Epirus, another good one. They'll end up at war with Rome most likely, unless they get wiped out, so we will try and get non-aggression pact with them, but it's not going to work. So that's the opening turn. That's pretty much all I can do this turn. We've tried our best, we've got some culture going, and now we click the end turn to see what happens. Oh, what happened here? Edict. Oh, we have an edict. Okay, so our edict is actually here. Like I said at the start of the video, Libya holds these three settlements, and we have these, Carthage, pardon me, so we can actually issue an edict. So what do we need? Now, Carthage is happy enough at the moment. I think mercenary hiring cost, building construction unit ships, wealth from all commerce buildings. Wealth would be useful. Food and public order is usually the best one. The tax rate, I'm going to go for the tax rate, though, because our public order is fine at the moment. And we're going to click end turn. So there we go. Ooh, pardon me. So, as expected, Rome has declared war on me straight away. We're going to call our allies to help. And they have joined. So there we go. We're going to be fighting Rome straight away. And Rome will probably... Oh, they won't attack us this turn. So yeah, Rome sometimes attacks you in the first turn. Sometimes they wait a few turns. There have actually been some people that have said they've had campaigns where Rome hasn't attacked them at all, and two big empires have formed and have never fought each other. So that would be interesting if that did happen, but of course it hasn't happened. They've actually declared war. So issue has been edict. Edict has been issued. That's what I meant to say. Trait gained by Mago, so he's wary of strangers. War declared. Syracuse, then Epirus. Etzitani and Sesitani. So these are things you need to be wary of. If we click on the diplomacy screen again, we're at war with Rome now, so the Etruscans like us even more probably, so we'll go for a trade agreement this time. And again, they don't want to trade with us, so that's a shame. It's a shame, shame, shame. Epirus, will you join my hands? Nope. It's quite difficult to actually get anything with Carthage, because everyone hates them. Libya, of course, Libya you want to get with, because they have all this land, so will you trade with me? Moderate. They will, if I pay them, which is fine, because I want them to be on my good side. So we got a bit more money coming in now. Now, of course, the Etruscans will probably lose against Rome. As a matter of fact, they've lost Velathri already, so Rome are going to be building up pretty strong soon. That's why it's important that I get there as quickly and efficiently as I can. I need one more turn to get this muster field. I have a public forum, which can be upgraded. Amphitheater. Grain market, maybe. Nothing to worry about at the moment, I don't think. I need to wait for that muster field. I am going to recruit another javelin unit, though. Lilibium. I probably need another army nearby, so Lilibium would be the way to go. But let's have a quick look at my faction. So, Barsid is just Hannibal. Gizgo is Hananoid. Mago, and then Himilcar. So, They're all the other dynasties shared, basically. What we're going to do is raise forces. And we're going to go for... Don't have any bastard ones here, do we? No. We'll go for Himilcar, I think. We'll go with Himilcar. We'll raise an army. And look at that. African war elephants. We will definitely get them. And that's the thing I should mention with the units. At the moment, Hannibal is actually on a horseback. But you can get war elephants. Which I might try and get, actually. Let's have a look. Details. General details. Unfortunately, you have to replace and then replace again, which is stupid. But I'm not going to do it for now. But yeah, that's something you should consider when you're getting generals with Carthage. You can actually get them on war elephants. So it would be worth it. What you lose in being stretched, your lands are being stretched all over the place, you gain with African war elephants. So it would definitely be a good strategy. And that's basically it for that part of the world. Let's go over to this part of the world. How are we doing over here? So one more turn now for the muster field and one more turn for the consecrated ground. We can actually expand Carthage again, which we will do. We can get another consecrated ground for the public order. We can get another muster field. We don't need that. We actually want the public forum because we get the plus one public order on top of the wealth. So we're going to go for that. And our general, who is sitting here in a ship. He's actually in a ship on land, not on ship. We're actually going to recruit some more Libyan javelins. Out of curiosity, what can we get out of mercenaries? So these are the mercenaries here. But look at that. Mercenary Scutari cavalry is 285 per turn. Just not worth it, is it? There are lots of troops you can get as mercenaries, but... You know, if you're going to go down the mercenary route, I would definitely recommend going for the mercenaries trait here. Once you research that, it's another minus 15% mercenary upkeep and recruitment cost. So that's what you should do. And there we have it. So we've been rather careful here, but I know how quickly a Carthage campaign can unravel. So that's why. Corrales, I've not done anything with Corrales at the moment. That's fine. I'm not worried about Corrales. If I lost Corrales, it wouldn't be the end of the world. Keep Carthage and try and keep Lilibium. They're the two you need to keep. And work from the south and try and push your way up. Take Syracuse, take Crescentia, take Brundisium. And hopefully get something with Epirus along the way as well. Which I don't think is going to happen. Let's have a look. Epirus, where are you? Non-aggression, please. Moderate. There we go, non-aggression power with Epirus. Trade is low. It's not going to work. But that's something we can build upon. We've actually got a green face with them now. So we might actually get something with them. Eventually. So that's probably the end of this turn. We still have 735 left to spend, which I can actually recruit here in the form of Libyan javelins. So we'll get two Libyan javelins here to join that army, and we're going to click end turn once more. And there we go. Being very, very, very cautious about this because I know, like I said, how quickly these campaigns can unravel. We haven't even got to a battle stage yet. And there we go. The Etruscan League now want a defensive alliance. And they are willing to offer us 380. To be honest with you, it's not worth it. I don't think because... Although saying that, I'm already at war with Rome. Their only enemy is Rome. Yeah, it's free money. Okay, so we'll accept that. It's free money. We'll accept that. Because there's 380 denarii on top, which can go towards buying another unit or two. You've got to think of things strategically like that. There we go. Research complete. And population surplus is at Corsica and Etzidan. Oh my god, Sardinia. Speaking too quick. There we go. So, now we have our muster field. We actually have some decent units. So now we can recruit. Look at that. Look at the difference. Libyan hoplites, 24 melee. Carthaginian hoplites, 36. Weapon damage, 20. Weapon damage, 29. Bonus versus large, 30. Bonus versus large, 20. Okay, so slightly less. Charge bonus, 20. Charge bonus, 20. Melee defense 51, melee defense 39. Armor 80, armor 55. Health 60, health 45. Base morale 61, base morale 49. So as you can see, they cost, let's see, 120 upkeep per turn. Ways of paying 80. So for that extra 40, you're getting a much better unit. So we want to get a few of them, of course. I'm actually going to spend, well, I've got three of them all together because we need them, and Hannibal can go across here and fight them there. That's what we're going to do with him. That is how we would plan our Carthage campaign in this faction overview. And over here, Carthage, we actually have our consecrated ground. still minus 14 per turn, and why would that be? So let's have a look. Our cultural differences are still minus 12, which is a shame. Our taxes as well are causing some problems. How can we counteract this? Well, we're going to have a public forum soon, which will help.
Ready for battle.
And we can, of course, get some Carthaginian hoplites here as well. So that's what you've got to do. Wait out until you can get Carthaginian hoplites, because they are much better at this stage of the campaign. I think that's pretty much all we can do this turn. We have 573 left to spend. Lilibayam, we can't do anything in Lilibayam. We have a consecrated ground, which will help our public order and will spread our culture. We have our ships here. We're in a very defensive position in case Syracuse decides to come out. I'm also keeping my spy. Actually, my spy can go north. It's not needed there. You can go towards Crescentia. There we go. We can see what Rome has for us. And Crescentia is actually relatively well undefended. So we can, of course, go there and attack them there. And that's pretty much it for the opening few turns. I'm going to click end turn once more. And then we'll see. And I'll probably wrap up the video then, because it's been going on for a while, I think. But that's pretty much it with Carthage. Get the Carthaginian hoplites. Get rid of the Libyan hoplites, I think. I'll probably start getting rid of them once I'm starting to build my armies up, because they are much better. Carthaginian ones are much better. Encourage populace, Africa, that's good. Trait gained, Himilcar, Latin culture plus growth. And there we have it. So, look at that. Much better army now. Look much better, don't they? We're going
to
actually get
three
more, and then this army will be beastly. This guy will trade with him, so one general goes there, one general goes there to keep Carthage safe. Actually, you know, we could probably use both of them. One can go for Syracuse, while one can go for Rome. We still have 800 to spend if we sail across the Mediterranean back over here. Public order is still bad, although it's only minus 6 per turn now. So we've reduced that quite a bit. And it's minus 11 cultural differences now, so it's gone down, as you can see. And it's going to be 11 turns until the rebellion, so that's important to note. And as you can see, Punic is on the way up as well, so it's going to go down slightly, which is the important thing. But I think that pretty much sums up the faction overview with Carthage. These are the things you must look out for. So to summarize, this video, get muster fields as quickly as you can in Carthadash and in Carthage itself. That way you can recruit superior troops in Carthaginian hoplites compared to your Libyan hoplites. Mercenaries, it's totally up to you. You do have a bonus, but again, you know, it's up to you whether you want them or not. Personally, I don't think you need them. They're just a waste of money, and you can get much better troops by yourself if you're prepared to wait a few more turns. That's if you're going to take on this kind of area of Spain and hold Carthadash. Other things to mention as well, as I should say, your generals, when you recruit new generals or your existing generals, replace them with elephants, because they are much better and they can easily get 500, 600, 700 kills before they get taken out. So it's worth to keep the note. Although saying that, the only thing you must watch out for is that you don't throw them into javelin men or spearmen, because they are deadly against war elephants. But apart from that, go nuts for them. Throw them into the Roman legions. They're definitely going to be useful against them. And that pretty much sums up this video. So this has been a faction overview of Carthage for Total War Rome 2. I've been Dragonheart, the Prince of Wales. Thank you for watching. Until next time, goodbye.